got a thing about trains. I get a sad kind of feeling when I see a passenger train. In this fast-moving world that we live in, nobody rides much these days.
Maybe I got my watch in my pocket. I thought this is a matter of funniness. I might say, I'll give you a few minutes here before the crew is called, so if that's all right with
you. That's the official railroad watch. What is your name, please?
Stuart Ladner.
Paul Held.
My name is James Mitchell.
Paul Mushrush.
Lewis Rich.
Dale Finney.
Charles E. Barry.
Fred Crowley.
Sam Simonette.
My name's Charley Zilhaver.
How many years did you work for the railroad?
21 years.
4 or 5.
25.
43.
45.
I started out as an apprentice. Every 3 to 6 months, we would go to a different job.
I was an extra operator in the depot.
A switchman, yard switchman.
I started out as a trainman.
I started out as a fireman.
As a fireman on the steam engines, and I was promoted to engineer.
I was a fireman for 4 years, and the firemen are trained to be engineers, but it takes 4 years.
A friend of mine was working on a railroad. He came up one day and said, "Dude, what are you doing for a living?" I said, "Well, I'm working on a farm and everything." And he says, "Well, how would you like to work for the railroad?" And I said, "I don't know anything about the railroad." And he says, "That's okay, you'll learn." And I did.
I started August something or other, 1927. I spent 2 years in Allegheny College, and I ran out of money. After all, the tuition was $250 a year, and I would work for the railroad a while, get enough money to go back to school. So I went over and applied for it and got the job. So.
Can you tell us what your feelings were that first day when you were solely in charge?
I was a nervous wreck.
Were you?
To say the least. I mean, I'd run the engine many, many times, but when you sat in the seat first time, you're the one in charge. You're the one, if any mistakes is made, you're the one they're going to come back on.
I was scared to death. We had 3 days, what they call hostling service. And that's just moving engines around the roundhouse for sand and fuel and maintenance. Train master came out to me, and I was just sitting on the bench waiting for the action to begin. He says, "Have you ever been on one of these locomotives?" I said, "No." He says, "Well, let's go out and take a look." I said, "Okay." So I went out there, and I mean, here's this locomotive, a monster to me, you know. We got up in the cab, and I mean, switches everywhere, levers everywhere. And I says, "I don't want to kid you. You got the wrong guy." He said, "Well, what do you mean by that?" And I says, "There's no way in the world that I would learn to run this locomotive." And he said, "You'll be all right." Scared the bejeevers out of me, first trip, you know. I mean, you're way up in this locomotive and the track looks like it's 2 inches wide in front of you, and you're not slowing down for anything. And you're wondering, boy, I hope this guy's really good, you know. Because the signals are flying by and the poles are flying by and other trains are flying. That's a scary thing. When two trains, you know, now you're doing double speed here. And he's going north, you're going south, and you're just praying to God. You think, "Oh, gosh, all Friday. Hope this baby stays on the track."
At 3 o'clock in the morning one time, there was a derailment in Sagertown. That was on a westbound track. In those days, there was no wireless phone stuff and no CB radios. They had, now the railroad had their own telephones, but they didn't have communications between the railroads and any office. This, I'm talking about the early 50s. I got a call on a railroad telephone down the depot. A westbound train will be there in about an hour and a half, and they said, "You close the office. This is an emergency, and you go to Cambridge Springs and stop that train." Well, hand on a train order. They have to stop the train before it gets to Sagertown. I'd only been there about 2 weeks at that time. And to hand on a train order, what they have is a bamboo pole. Here's a bamboo pole, and they call it a fork. The pole is like this, lightweight, and there's clips here, clips here, clips here, and the string, it goes up round here, round there, and there's a tie a message on there. Because a train, I'll tell you in a minute why they had to have a train on it. And what happens, the engineer, he reaches out with his arm, this is about 2 feet, see, he reaches out and lines his arm up and he goes through there and it pulls off that string and he's got the message. And there's a derailment ahead of him and there's a switch down here by Venango. He had to stop at the block and switch over and go west on an eastbound track. But they cannot do that unless they have written order. It has to be in writing. I grabbed this fork, they called it. I'd never done this before. And I lead up to Cambridge Springs and had two red lanterns. And here come this freight train barreling down. You stand up there and lanterns and do this, do that. Now that's no signal to stop, but it means there's caution and pay attention. And he does this with his light, meaning he knows he saw me. So I set the lanterns down and here I take this bamboo pole, it's light like a fish pole. And what I have to do is hold it up there. So, and he reaches out the cab because he had 92 cars on his freight train and you don't stop on a dime. And he didn't want to stop anyway. So I wasn't sure just how close to get. I didn't want to get too close to the engine because I didn't want to hit it. So like a dummy, I kind of held it back a little bit. And when he got about 20 feet from where he had to get it, I go like this with it. Well, he'd already was reaching way out here, had his arm focused. He would have got it. So I go like this, I missed it.
You missed it.
Oh, missed. And I stood there devastated, and I knew he had to have it. They put the air on, and you can hear sparks flying. And the fireman, he finally got stopped way down past Turner's mill there. And I'm running down.
You're going
down. It's dark. I didn't have a flashlight. And that red lantern don't give much light anyway. And running down along the flag. And here comes the fireman running back to get that train order. And I'll never forget that as long as I live.
You have to be shaking
that night. Yeah, I'm laughing now, but I wasn't then.
It called from Meadville to New York, about how long it took in those days?
Yeah, it was probably 10 hours.
So you could use a weekend and go up there?
Oh, yeah, we did, yeah. My sister and I used to go up there on my dad's pass, and we'd see the Rockettes, Warren Theater. They had Tommy Dorr and all those big bands, you know. We'd see that, and if you get up early, it only cost us a quarter to get in. And at night, it was about $15, $20.
Just imagine.
Yeah.
My family, Sandy, she might have been a little younger, but we would go to New York City for any excuse at all. I had the privilege of riding the trains free of charge, and I was a Pullman agent, so I had a Pullman pass. There's two different passes, one for just the railroad and one for the Pullman company. And we could get what they called a double bedroom, go to New York free of charge. The only cost, we'd eat on the diner because it didn't cost as much, and then we go to New York to give you an idea of the Christmas show, Easter pageant, Radio City Music Hall.
Well, that was a pretty good perk.
I got to know New York about as well as I know Meadville. Also, to add that there was a Chesterfield Hotel in New York City down on 42nd Street that catered to railroad employees, and they'd give us a half rate to stay at that motel, or hotel. It wasn't a motel, it was a hotel. And we took advantage of that. One story that I'll never forget, a prominent doctor in Cambridge Springs was known now and then to get a little bit too much to drink. He came in the station one night about 9:30, staggering, cussing a little bit, quite a little bit, and then he left. Well, we had the passenger train coming in from New York going to Chicago, the last one of the night, and I looked out the window and there he was standing right in the middle of the track, shaking his fist, yelling something at that train. The lights, you could see the lights on him. I ran out of the station yelling at him to get off the track, get off the track. He didn't move. I literally took a flying leap and knocked him off the track, and by that time I believe the train was almost at Church Street Crossing. I know I saved his life as well as jeopardizing. I came close, but I didn't have the second thought, and I had to hang on to him. My pants were torn. He was wrestling me like you couldn't believe, and I could just literally had a death grip on him, trying to hold him down.
When he was sober, did he realize what he had done?
No, he didn't.
Never mentioned it?
No.
Oh, that Howard Johnson was crazy.
Oh, yeah.
Poor old soul, he's 6 foot now. We got a cherry train out of Kent one day, and we'd run them as fast as you could with safety. And I hated to get a cherry train with Howard.
Yeah.
But he'd take off and he'd just go. As fast as that thing would run, he had passenger engines on, or steam engine. Well, you just hang on for your dear life and hope you made it. And then he'd take these curves, 50 mile an hour curves, you go around them darn things, 60, 65. Oh.
Were there any instances of, or periods of time when you were frightened? Or were there accidents? And can you tell us anything about those exciting days?
Oh, I never forget this one when I was scared to death. We were on the test train going from Meadville to Jamestown and to Buffalo. And it goes down, go on the hill. And we normally stop at the top of the hill of South Dayton and turn up retainers in order to keep the brakes on some of the cars going down the hill, which is 2.5% grade, which is very steep. The general manager was on there that night, and he didn't know how to run an engine, but he was ragging the engineer all the way. So we started down the hill, and the engineer was nervous about this general manager. And he waited a little bit too long to put the air on. So the further we went, the faster we went. And the mountains are on one side, and the Genesee River's down in the valley down below us on the other side. And it was not a straight piece of track in that thing. And we roomed up one side of the curve and slammed down on the other side. We thought every minute we were going to wreck. Well, we supposed to stop before we ever got to go on the station. But we went right past there like it wasn't there. The only guy that wasn't scared on there that night was his general manager's male secretary, because he thought we always went down there that way.
He didn't know the difference.
He didn't know the difference. Then they took that poor engineer out of road service and put him on a switch engine. He was demoted, but we always thought that the general manager should have been the one to be fired.
We had a bar, I'd say 2.5 inches. And when we changed bearings in the locomotive, the bearing cap was probably 75 pounds, and it had a thin 1/8 bearing underneath it. And you had to get that out of a big hole like this, and it's hard to do. And we'd get it out, and then the foreman would inspect the bearing to make sure it's all right, and we'd put it back, or we'd put a new one in. But this long bar we used to tighten the bolts down. I was taken and I just flipped over on my back, and there's a machinist behind me. I hit him in the head. I remember that plainly.
How much damage did you do to it?
Not that bad.
Were derailments rather common in those early days?
Not too common, but I remember very distinctly one that happened just around Randolph Hill, right near Jamestown, coming down this hill. I was on the engine, and I heard the engineer say, "There they go." And I felt the air go on, and I looked back, and there was cars going every which way back there and dumping into people's yards. We found out there was a broken truck frame that had caused this derailment. There was 19 cars, I think it was, that were dumped into some people's yard. Some of them were full of hard coal, so those people had enough coal to last them for the next 15 or 20 years.
You know, I'll tell you a good story about that, too. I was going west one time on a diesel train with tape recorders on them. We was going down to that there just this side of Greenville. My fireman was running the engine at the time, and he ran it exactly as I told him to, so he was doing it just fine. And he was going 55 mile an hour coming down. There's a curve down there, 40 mile an hour, and he was slowing up for that curve with the brakes on. And we was coming, going underneath the Bessemer Railroad, going overhead. And pretty soon the air train went in emergency. So I looked back on my side there, and then the next thing I seen was a boxcar standing right on end, coming down that road 50 mile an hour on end. And it hit the Bessemer tracks. And the Bessemer bridge went up in the air and come down. And then by that time, I was around the curve and I couldn't see anymore. So we stopped. And I went back to see what's going on there. And the Bessemer Railroad, all there was the rails hanging there. The bridge was gone. And the creek down there, Shenango River down there, was full of our cars down in the river. So I got on the radio there and called Shenango Tower and told them if there's any Bessemer trains in the vicinity, get them stopped because their bridge is gone. He says, what? What? What'd you say? He couldn't believe what I was talking about. I said, there's no bridge at Osgood. Stop any trains in that area. So he got them stopped, and there was a train coming down the hill. So anyway, officials, they all come down, you know. They had to come down and see what's going on. The first thing they did, they got on the engine and they zipped. Opened up the speed recorders and took out the tapes. See if we'd been speeding or anything, you know. We hadn't been. Everything was all right. So they left, and my fireman looked at me, and he says, what are we going to do? I says, I think we better go up over that hill and don't stop till we get clear to Alaska. Because this don't look good back there. Somebody's going to get... They're going to have to blame somebody for something. And when we got to Youngstown, we had to stop at Youngstown. All the officials from Youngstown, they come on the engine also. First thing they did was open up the speed recorders and got for the tapes. No tapes. Turned around and looked at me with a big funny look. Where's the tapes? I said, you didn't expect me to leave them on here, did you? They're down the Shenango River. They about died. If they'd had a gun, they would have shot me right there. So anyway, we come back the next day, and we was the first train back through there again. The superintendent in Youngstown was down there on the ground. He was standing down there like that, going like that there. I said to my fireman, get out and see what he wants. My fireman said, you don't want to talk to me. So I went down. He said, Paul, he says, I hear all kinds of stories, he says. Tell me how fast you was going when this happened down here. I said, well, we were coming down the hill there, 55 mile an hour or better, and we were slowing up for the 40 mile an hour curve. Everything was fine. He said, well, don't worry about it. We're going to have to investigate. You know, there's going to be an investigation. But don't worry about it because we know what happened, and it wasn't your fault. And what it was a 1918 tank car, and those truck frames was cast iron, and they had fractured. They had, I don't forget how many fractures those old castings had had in them. Finally, some yardmaster in Meadville put that in my train to get rid of it, get rid of that car. And there we come down there with that car, and it's just bumping and jumping up and down like that there, and that truck frame just disintegrated. And that's what caused their accident.
What advice would you give to any young man who might be interested in the railroad industry today?
Well, the railroad industry today is nothing compared to what it was. And I just don't think there are any opportunities there now. So,
Will, in your mind, there ever be a time when passenger travel will be popular again in the United States?
I don't think so.
You think it's dead?
Yeah. The only thing is, some people, I guess, are riding Conrail for long distances on train, but I think most people are flying or driving.
So the good old days are gone?
I'm afraid so.
The day I walked out of there, it was like I never worked for the railroad before. I'd come across Smock Bridge, I wouldn't even think to look down the yard. No, it was done.
Got a thing about trains. I get a sad kind of feeling when I see a passenger train. In this fast-moving world that we live in, nobody rides much these days. Maybe I'm a little sentimental.
Would you do it all over again?
I think I would.
Probably would. Yeah, I enjoyed my work.
No question about that. Absolutely. I loved it.
Yeah, I think I probably would have.
You enjoyed your work?
Yes, I did. It wasn't work for me. When you get in that locomotive and you're starting on your trip, it's quite a feeling that you're setting up high, of course, in the locomotive and looking down at the people on the ground and so on. You just have a sense of power.
I loved it. I did.
I loved working for the railroad. It just got into my blood.
You know, a lot of people go through life not liking their job. Never had that problem. Of course, the years fly by because of it, I guess. I don't know. But I have no regrets of my railroad career at all.
For traveling, but I'm gonna miss you someday when my little boy says, Daddy, what was it like to ride a train? I'll just say it was a good way to travel when things didn't move quite so fast. And I'm sorry, son, that you can't ride one. The trains are a thing of the past. Train, train, train. You're fading from the scene. And I'm gonna mourn your passing. Train. Got a thing about trains.